Hi, my name is Reggie Lugo. I'm a student at the Journalism School at the University of Texas at Austin. Today we sat down with Rich Meislin, Associate Managing Editor for Internet Publishing at the New York Times, and also a contributor to the Hybrid Newsroom for a Digital Age panel at the International Symposium for Online Journalism. All right, so I guess to help our viewers kind of get an understanding of what it means to be the Associate Managing Editor of Internet Publishing at the Times, when you started Workday in New York, what'd you say are some of your goals and challenges for that day?
Well, it's not a very day-to-day job. I'm involved more in the container of the website than the contents that get poured into it every day. And so I deal more than some other people do in things like the strategy of the site, the overall effort and integration that I am on what's going on the homepage this minute, or what video do we have ready for tonight. I deal a lot with people who are interested in creating blogs. I deal a lot with new things that we're trying out or talking about trying out. I deal a lot with issues that arise having to do with advertising and how that gets used on the site. And so those are the kinds of things that I deal with.
So I guess you've been at the Times for pretty much your whole career.
Pretty much since I left college,
right.
Yeah.
Okay. You talked a little bit about in the presentation about going from barely having an online presence to being one of the leaders, the leader pretty much in online newspapers. Aside from being the New York Times, what would you say has contributed the most to the success of the website? And what have been some of the guiding principles for you?
Well, I think being the New York Times has helped every stage of the way. The Times is one of the highest quality news organizations out there. Our credibility lends us a tremendous amount of weight in whatever medium that we're working in. I think we've been helped as the years have gone by staying on top of the kinds of changes that are going on in the industry, by changing the way that we think, by taking advantage of the assets that the New York Times brings to the table in terms of the incredible amount and the incredible quality of information it produces each day. But then there's sort of the added element of working to adapt what the New York Times has created for years for an audience that is interested in somewhat different things, and sort of thinking more generally about how we go beyond being just the New York Times newspaper's presence on the web. I think that's very important for us and something that we spend a lot of time thinking about, how you get the audience engaged in what you're doing. The fact is there are lots of different kinds of audiences that come to see the New York Times on the web, and we need to be able to serve different audiences in different ways. So we have dedicated readers who read the New York Times website in much the same way as our print readers read the New York Times newspaper, but we have lots of people who come to the site looking for things in different ways. And the example that I spoke about this morning in terms of finding travel information in a way that you can actually plan a trip, or finding health information in a way that allows you to get answers about a variety of conditions that you may or a family member may have. Those are all services that we can provide.
Liza grows from the Miami Herald. She talked a little bit about a continuous news desk and a lot of the collaboration that goes on in the newsroom. How much interaction would you say that you or your department has with new reporters and editors?
It's constant at this point. There are producers from the web operation on every major news desk. So the foreign desk has its own producer, the national desk has its own producer, Metro has a number of producers, so does business. And one of the things that has happened as a result of having people in physical proximity of each other, an amazing amount of what goes on in planning the daily news report in any amount of time involves either on-the-fly meetings or overheard conversations, something where somebody says, we're going to send somebody out to look at this on the Metro desk, and the web person is there to say, hey, what are we going to be doing on this for the web? We can mobilize ourselves a lot better than we could just a year ago before we actually started putting people next to each other, and it's made a really big difference for us. But the interchange between a variety of reporters and editors and web people is much, much more fluid than it was, say, 2.5 years ago.
When you're discussing a story with a reporter or an editor, how do you decide what kind of internet presence that story should have, whether it should be like an audio slideshow or
In the same way you decide what kind of package you're going to put together, you know, it's a very similar kind of judgment to the ones that we've made in years for print, for years in print. It's a matter of knowing what resources you have available to you and trying to figure out how you tell the story the best way that you can. What's great now is that we have all these new tools that we can use that we didn't have before. And so, for example, 3 years ago, when the federal, 4 years ago, to be more accurate about it, when the federal election campaign would put out the data from candidates' campaign contributions, we would write a text story describing what was in the reports. Now what we do is we put up a database and people can search by amount, by place, by contributor, and see on a map at the same time where the locuses of contributions are for the various candidates. And it's an experience that you just wouldn't have had before because you didn't have the tools. And so being able to do those kinds of things and getting people to think about what having those tools mean are an important part of what we're trying to do.
When the Spitzer story broke, I mean, that situation was a situation where it was very sort of minute to minute, and a lot of consequential things happening very fast. How do you approach a breaking news story like that when, you know, the print publication can't really help you out, and just online is pretty much be all and end all?
No, but print, that's not the distinction isn't print versus non-print. The people who were involved in that in print, I was out of the country at the time, so I wasn't directly involved in this, but this was all extremely well coordinated with the website, and it's the same reporters, and it's the same editors, and that's sort of the whole point of the advantages that we're gaining by integrating the newsroom more closely, is that these are all people who are working together day after day, and people's judgments in how you handle a story like that are getting more flexible as time goes on. One of the main things that we have pretty much overcome, although not entirely, is the whole idea that if you have an exclusive, it's most important to have that exclusive printed in the printed New York Times in the morning. People in the newsroom now understand in a very clear way, and stories like the Spitzer story are perfect examples of it, that the place where the competition is taking place is online, and that the place you need to break stories is online, because if you don't, somebody else will break them online somewhere else before you get to print the newspaper. And that kind of change in mindset has been really groundbreaking for us.
The panel today was basically about integration of print and digital. But even as far as newspapers have come, it seems that there's still a lot of ground to cover, for instance, in terms of bringing multimedia aspects and text stories closer together.
Mm-hmm.
How do you see, you know, online publishing of newspapers evolving in the near future?
Well, in the near future, I think you're going to see more integration, and in fact, you're already seeing more integration of things like slideshows, audio slideshows, audio that accompanies stories, all of that has become more and more routine in our newsroom and is more and more routine appearing on the site. One of the things that we're working on now is thinking more broadly than the web. We have a mobile website which had, I believe it was 500,000 page views a year ago and 10 million page views last month. The growth in that has been tremendous, and we're going through some similar things from what we went through in making print people conscious of the web presence. We sometimes need to make web people conscious of our mobile presence so that things carry through all the way down the line, because we're serving all the people in all different media. It's a matter of community and getting more involvement by our readership on the site. The Times has one of the smartest groups of readers out there, and we would be fools not to take increasing advantage of the kinds of information that an audience like that can provide to us. So you're already seeing it in things like movie reviews and travel destinations and areas like that. But and in the copious comments that we get back to our blogs. But that's something in which you're going to see us dedicating more efforts as the months go by.
I think that about does it. Thank you so much for your time, and it's been a real pleasure.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Sure.